So I agree with the words, but there's something I don't agree with. I don't agree that laws are what Eddie called primitive facts. Now, I'm not exactly sure what primitive facts are, so I think it's useful to go back with a little history. Do you mind that?
Sure.
You do mind it?
No, please do.
Okay. I think it's very interesting to think about the history of the concept of laws. First most interesting thing is no one has written a history of the concept of laws of nature. There's one book that kind of comes a little bit close, but nobody has really done it. If I were a historian, I would think that that's, you know, ripe, we're just right on the tree, ready to be plucked off. People have written histories of probability and chance, a closely related notion. No one's written a history of the concept of law. So the concept of law in the modern sense really has a father. I won't ask you to guess who the father was. It is Father's Day today, isn't it?
Okay.
Well, maybe we should celebrate this guy.
All right.
He's a pretty French, famous French philosopher. I bet you know who I'm talking about.
Rousseau?
No. Come on. He was interested in breaking the laws, not in Much more famous than Rousseau. The most famous man.
Descartes?
If you go into Paris, you walk down Rue Descartes. Okay, Descartes. So Descartes was the father, really. I mean, this is a little bit of an exaggeration, but father of the concept of modern concept of laws of nature. He had a vision. His vision was that there could be a few principles that could be expressed in mathematics, which are not primitive facts at all. What they do is they describe how God moves matter around. Descartes had the view that all activity in the universe was due to God. So Descartes had this view that what the laws were, where they describe how God moves things around. It was God who did the constraining, God who did the enforcing, God who moved things around. So they described how God constrains things. But they weren't primitive facts. They described what God was doing. They had two important features. One was what Eddie was calling the constraining, or what's usually called the governing feature. And the other was the unifying feature. They unified all of nature. And of course, they're also mathematical. And you know why Descartes knew that the laws had to be mathematical? Because he thought God must be a mathematician. Because he was a mathematician. Okay, this is the history. Really, honestly, the history of when the notion of law originated. And the people who've written about it, I can give some references to scholars. A guy named Peter Harrison, another person named John Milton, not the poet, another one. The philosopher who's written a close to a history is a person called Walter Ott, but he doesn't really do it. So it would be an interesting thing for somebody to do. Okay, so the concept of laws started, I'm going to stop in a minute. The concept of laws had these two aspects at the very beginning, the unifying or organizing aspect and the constraining aspect. What Eddie has done is picked up on one of the aspects. I've picked up on the other aspect. And the reason I've done that is I find the constraining aspect absolutely ununderstandable. What does it mean for the laws to constrain? How do they do it? Is there a super law that's appealed to make them constrain? Or does it just happen automatically because they're laws? There's a third alternative here. Some people think that the things in nature themselves have powers and they produce the laws. Aristotle kind of had a view like that, but he didn't have that as a mathematical view about laws. But other people in contemporary times have taken up that view. It doesn't work very well in contemporary physics. Okay, but these are the main three views. There are a few other views around. So Eddie and I are here to battle unifying versus constraining. Eddie might want to say both. I say jettison the constraining, because once you have the unifying, you got everything you need.
Okay, so when you said super law, is there a super law that governs the regular laws? The analogy to Descartes would be the super law is God, and God is the one governing.
Absolutely, you got it, Curt.
Okay, so the way that I see the disagreement between you both is that we can think of traffic laws as an analogy, and most of us would say that traffic laws cause the motion, or orchestrate at least the motion of the cars. But then there's also something like a weather report where we're just documenting patterns that we observe. So it sounds like, Eddie, you're more on the traffic laws are the laws, and then Barry, you're more on, we're just summarizing, these are just descriptions of what's occurring.
You're really good, Curt. That's a very good way to put it.
Okay. Thank you. Or at least
it's very favorable to my point. You know, but I mean, notice this. In the other room, I can come out because I've driven just once in Budapest. I managed to get a ticket during that one time. So it's, you can violate the laws of man. Nature cannot violate the laws of God.
Why not?
Well, that's a really good question, isn't it? Why not? Well, maybe because laws just unify nature. So there's nothing there to violate.
I think there is this question of what's explaining the no exception clause for summaries view. So suppose we don't think laws govern, laws constrain. Suppose we think that laws merely summarize and unify. What's about the laws of nature that they have no exceptions? They apply to almost everything, or everything literally, in the universe.
Yeah. They unify everything. Isn't that interesting? We live in, well, first of all, we don't really know that because general relativity and quantum mechanics have not been unified, as I was reminded last night with my string theorist friend. Going into that. And I didn't have to be reminded of it, of course. But the hope is, Einstein had this hope. Einstein, who many people think of as at some point in his life, he became a believer in God. I've read Einstein pretty closely. I don't think that's true. I'm not absolutely certain. But he did express faith. He expressed faith that a scientist has to have, that nature will be unified. And so science works under the assumption that he can find a unification, or she can find a unification of nature. And so far, it's worked. In fact, let me make another historical note, which I find astonishing. After Descartes proposed his project for the next millennia, finding the mathematical laws of nature, he wrote a few down. They were abysmal failure, actually, as laws of nature. They didn't, well, he kind of sort of came close to inertia, but he wasn't very good at it. Along 80 years later, another guy came along, the Frenchman's archenemy, Isaac Newton. And he basically satisfied Descartes' dream up to a point. If Descartes had lived to see Newton, I don't want to go into what I'm about to say couldn't be broadcast. I mean, it's amazing to think about what he would think. Newton came up with a few simple laws and a scheme for laws, which looked like it was going to unify all of nature. And many people thought for a long time that it did. It's not until he got into more careful examination that they discovered it didn't. Okay, but it does, and works very well. You know, if you want to get your pendulum clock working or your cannonballs flying in the right direction, Newton's laws are very good.
So I want to hear from Eddie about where he agrees and contrasts with your earlier views. So Eddie, please.
Yeah, so that's very helpful, Barry. I think that the two roles of laws are both important. And the unifying role is one we're motivated and aspire to find in the laws of nature. But without this constraint, the basic constraint, it's not clear how the unifying thing does any explanation, right? So I think it's taken for granted in many scientific communities that the laws, the principles we find in the end can explain, and they constrain or govern somehow. They explain how things fall in the right same way, how things move in the same right way. And of course, people focus on the unifying part. And they say, okay, what is the simplest way and most natural way and most unifying way we can find laws of nature write down, principles and equation write down that explains things? Of course, people are not very explicit about how laws explain. And there will be debates about this. And there will be two ways to cash out how people think about laws of nature. But I do think that the majority of scientists, the naive view, the flat-footed view, is the view that laws, even though they're nice, they have to satisfy this constrained relation or this governing role. Otherwise, they are not laws. They are not something we aspire to find in nature.
That's what you say. Now, Eddie, about you talking about taking advice from scientists, do you take advice from the general scientists about what you want to think about quantum mechanics?
Quantum mechanics is a difficult case.
Shut up and calculate, Eddie. Shut up and calculate. You do not. Of course, what scientists have done is they bought into Descartes' general picture and they started to using this language of governing. That's the language they're using, governing and constraining, as though they somehow couldn't do without it. It's like you had a crutch that you don't need anymore. You never used. It never held you up.
So maybe we should clarify the view of constraining and summarizing, and just for the audience. Maybe you should say
please.
First.
You put summarizing in my mouth. I did not say
okay,
summarizing.
Okay.
How about I summarize and also explain summarizing? I'll do so with an analogy again for people who are educated in physics. So maybe a germane analogy, you can tell me if this is germane or not, is the action principle. So we extremize action. Now, one could argue that the universe is genuinely extremizing its action. It's lazy if we're doing least action principle. Alternatively, someone can contend that that's just the stationary action principle is just an elegant way of summarizing what nature is doing. The principle itself isn't causative. It doesn't drive anything. It just encapsulates the behavior in a concise summary. So that's one way of viewing, or at least one way that I view the difference between a law of nature causing something. Now, what I'm confused about, Barry, is there some meta principle that says that the laws of physics are even describable by something simple? So you say that it's all unified, or it could be. There's something in algorithmic information theory called Kolmogorov complexity.
We both know it well.
And it could be, conceivably, that the universe is not compressible. It could be. It doesn't seem like that. I mean, it seems like we're able to write down something relatively short and do some predictions. So is there, in your mind, some meta principle that suggests that the universe is indeed compressible outside of initial conditions? And we can also talk about initial conditions.
We can. So a couple of things here. One is, I like the way you put things. I think it's good. When talking about the universe being compressible, you have to think about which parts you're going to compress. And the parts you're not going to compress, Kolmogorov complexity has a lot to do with, too. Because along in the 19th century, along came a couple of people who figured out how to supplement the laws of nature in a way so they give much, much more information about the ordinary facts in the world.
Just a moment. Don't go anywhere. Hey, I see you inching away. Don't be like the economy. Instead, read The Economist. I thought all The Economist was something that CEOs read to stay up to date on world trends. And that's true, but that's not only true. What I found more than useful for myself, personally, is their coverage of math, physics, philosophy, and AI, especially how something is perceived by other countries and how it may impact markets. For instance, The Economist had an interview with some of the people behind DeepSeek the week DeepSeek was launched. No one else had that. Another example is The Economist has this fantastic article on the recent dark energy data, which surpasses even Scientific American's coverage, in my opinion. They also have the chart of everything. It's like the chart version of this channel. It's something which is a pleasure to scroll through and learn from. Links to all of these will be in the description, of course. Now, The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means that you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments. I am personally interested in the more scientific ones, like this one on extending life via mitochondrial transplants, which creates actually a new field of medicine, something that would make Michael Levin proud. The Economist also covers culture, finance and economics, business, international affairs, Britain, Europe, the Middle East, Africa, China, Asia, the Americas, and of course, the USA. Whether it's the latest in scientific innovation or the shifting landscape of global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage, and it goes far beyond just headlines. Look, if you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a new understanding, a deeper one, of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. I subscribe to them, and it's an investment into my, into your intellectual growth. It's one that you won't regret. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now let's get back to the exploration of the mysteries of our universe. Again, that's economist.com/toe.